Hi guys, and welcome to this video. As for many easter approaches, I thought I'll show you how I've designed a 3D printable egg-shaped container. You could use this for hiding little precious presents for your loved ones. I wanted to have it resemble a real egg shape as closely as possible. This requires a little additional consideration with respect to the supports. So I'm using this example to show strategies I quite frequently use to simplify or entirely avoid support structures. As some of you wished for a more extended format, I decided to change things up just a little bit. Hence, this video consists of two parts, where in the first part I will outline the process in a very compressed fashion so you can get a quick overview. Then I will demonstrate my process more extensively so you can more easily follow along. Let me know what you think about this format in the comments. First, I quickly researched the actual shape of an egg. Interestingly enough, a paper giving a quite simple geometry consisting of only three arcs came up, link in the description. So I start with a sketch on the front plane, reproducing this shape. I only had to choose a total height and a wall thickness to fully define my initial egg-shaped sketch. Next, staying within the sketch, I choose the location where the upper and the lower part of the container should touch. I then design the cylindrical area where the interlocking thread will go. Then I think about the printing direction. I want the outside of the egg to be as clean as possible, so it should be the top side of both prints. I also want to avoid any supports on the inside, but luckily I don't care too much about the exact shape of the inside. So I add two lines to the inside, first on the top part. One line at the feasible overhang angle, I choose 55 degrees, and another horizontal line. This flat area will be bridged when printing, which works quite well with most materials and printer setups. Then I do the same for the bottom part, which will be printed upside down, obviously. Then I take care of the thread. I decide to design this a little simpler than what you might know from my threads tutorial, link in description. I go without the auxiliary bodies for the thread region and do a multiple starts thread. First, I sketch the trapezoidal profiles using projections from my first sketch. Here I added a tiny overlap to avoid any later problems with the sweeping. Also, I do not model any clearance between the thread profiles, and I do not care about the theoretically correct pitch, the reason for which we will see just in a second. I finish the sketch and create the base bodies. Then I've created the triangular coil as the guide. I do not need or in fact want much rotation to open and close the egg, so I only do 0.05 revolutions here, which means that the coil only extends to a 20th of a full circle, which is 18 degrees. The pitch value does not matter too much in this case. Just remember that opening the container gets harder the lower the pitch value is. I start with the top part and I sweep the profile along one of the coil's edges. Even if deviations should be small, if you do, don't forget to choose the path and guide surface option. I directly combine the resulting thread with the base body. Then I pattern the thread to multiple starts, selecting the feature option. Now I do the same for the bottom part. I sweep the first start of thread and then create the circular pattern of it. To keep my model clean, I remove the coil body. I create components from the bodies and have already finished my model function-wise. Now let's have a quick look at the threads in a section view. While the container itself is finished, there remains one unsolved problem with respect to the printing orientation. I cannot print this outside overhang on the top part without any supports. Using standard supports will give a very low quality face in the slices, I know. So I have decided to manually include a support structure in my design. Before doing such changes for printing, I like to create a copy of the component first. This way I get to keep one CAD model showing the final product while adding features that are solely necessary for printing to another. I have to use copy and paste new to achieve two independent components of the top part. For the support, I choose to follow a general way, which is in this case not the easiest one. I want to support this outer face on the top part, so I create the sketch on it. Then I offset the edges of this exact face towards the inner side, just slightly more than half of the printing line width I'm going to use. In this case, I use 0.25mm inset for a 0.4mm line width. This will give sufficient support while letting me remove the support part. After finishing the sketch, I extrude the inset profile I've just created up to the base face, which will be on the print bed. After printing, I can cut this curd-like structure from the part quite easily, even though I have used PETG with much better interlayer adhesion than most PLA materials. I use my scalpel, but an even shorter blade or a box cutter would have worked maybe even better. If you are wondering, I have used different seam settings on the top and bottom part to include some little experiment in this print. This is my final result after having given it a very quick and rough sanding. I was quite satisfied, but of course one could put much more effort into finishing. So now that you have a good idea of my process, if you stick around for the second part, I will continue with a more in-depth step-by-step tutorial. But of course, also feel free to try on your own first, and let's hope the algorithm will not punish me too much. If you find my content helpful, consider liking and subscribing, or even supporting me. Details in the description. So let's rewind. I create my first sketch on the front plane. First, I create a circle around the origin, which will be the bottom part of the egg. I add a second circle for the top. Following the drawing, I found the center of this circle has to lie on the first circle. Then I sketch a third circle, which will connect the two existing circles. Its center also lies on the first circle. Now I add a center line, choosing line type axis and constrain it to the center of the circle. I need an auxiliary line to constrain this third center point. Now I start trimming the circles. Sometimes it is better to break and convert to construction line to conserve constraints. Finally, I add the dimension, giving the overall height of the egg. I had measured an actual egg at 55 mm, that's why I chose this value here. It turns out that one constraint is still missing, so I add a coincidence between the axis and the first center point. Then I offset the sketch to the inside. After deselecting chain selection, I can deselect the center line from the curves to offset. I enter the offset value and click OK. Now I add the separation line between the top and the bottom part and set the dimension for that. The bottom part will have a cylindrical face in the threaded region, so I add a vertical line. The top part will have to extend towards this area, so I add a few lines for that feature. I add a parallel constraint before adding dimensions for the wall thickness. I estimate I will need 2 mm of radial space and 5 mm in the vertical direction for the thread. I want this thing to be attached slightly above the separation line, so I add another dimension of 0.4 mm. Now I trim the lines I do not need anymore. This is not strictly necessary, but facilitates selection of the profiles later. During this, a constraint and the dimension of the offset were lost, so I add them back. Now I add the lines to improve interior overhangs. One line is angled at a visible overhang angle, and the other line is horizontal, thereby enabling bridging. As I do not care too much about the inside shape, the choice of 4 mm as a radius of this face is quite arbitrary. Here, in order to not again lose constraints, I choose to break the original egg shape and then convert the construction line, hitting X on the keyboard. A little section remains, so I again break and convert to construction. Then I do the exact same thing on the bottom section of the egg. Only this time I again tried with the cut function and lost the constraint again. So I had to recreate a coincidence constraint between the point and the lower circle. Feel free to pause and have a closer look at the finished sketch. Now I create another sketch containing the thread profiles. First, I project the vertical lines as construction lines, so I can reference them more easily. Then I draw out the trapezoidal thread profiles. Here I hold the Ctrl key to avoid unwanted constraints. I just let go when I close the polygons. Here I do not want to model any clearances, so I set the two touching faces collinear. These other two faces should be parallel, and then I fix all the vertical lines. I continue by adding dimensions until the sketch is fully defined. I again choose overhang angles of 55 degrees. The slight overlap between the base catch and the back of the thread profiles is to make sure that the swept bodies will join nicely with the base bodies. After finishing the sketch, I create the base bodies by doing a revolution for each. For the second body, I have to select the new body option manually to not have it joined to the pre-existing one. Then I rename the bodies to not get confused. Now I create the coil as a guide for the threads. I select the top plane as reference and sketch out a circle. I want to have a triangular cross section and reduce the section size. I want to only create a very short piece of the thread here, so I choose to create 0.05 revolutions, which is a 20th of a full circle. I will do 6 pieces of the thread and need an equal amount of space to assemble and disassemble, so 1/12 would be the absolute minimum here. I select a pitch of 10 mm, which will result in a rather tightly closed egg. The printed one I've shown had a pitch of 20 mm and it was quite loose. Now that I have my guide ready, I can create the threads. I will start with the top and hide the bottom body. I create the sweeping, select the thread profile as profile and one edge of the guide coil as path. Although there is hardly any difference in this case, the correct way here is to select the path and guide surface option and select the top plane as guide surface. I let Fusion join the sweeping with the top body. Then I create the circular pattern of the piece of the thread. As the bodies have already been joined, I select the feature option and select the thread feature from the timeline. After selecting the axis, I set the number of instances to 6 and finish the pattern command. The top part is finished now. I hide it and do the same for the bottom part. I sweep the thread profile along the coil edge using the top plane as guide surface and join the result to the base body. Then I create the circular pattern of this feature, just as before. Now I can remove the coil body to keep my model nice and clean. Then, by right-clicking on Bodies, I put the two bodies into separate components. I select Display Component Colors to have them colored nicely. Then I inspect my result by creating a section view and moving the section plane through my model by dragging the arrow. As this looks fine, I continue by working on the overhang issue. For that, I create an independent copy of the X top component. I right-click and select Copy. Then I right-click on the parent component and select Paste New. This new component is independent in the sense that future changes will be applied only to one of the components. Changes in the preceding timeline, however, would of course still be propagated to both components. I rename the new component for clarity. Then I activate it. Now I create a new sketch on the unsupported face. I create an offset of the inner edge of this face first. I want it to be inset by 0.25 mm, which is slightly more than half of my printing line width. I do the same for the outer edge. Here I have to use a negative sign as I want to inset the circle. I finish the sketch and extrude the ring I've just sketched. I choose Extend to Object and select the face which will be placed on the print pad. This way, later changes cannot result in inconsistencies here. I again have a look at the section view and I'm satisfied with my result. This green model is used for printing now, and the turquoise one represents the final model after removing the support section. I hope you're also happy with your result and found this helpful. Feel free to share any feedback in the comments. Have a great time designing and prototyping.